sought the Lord, and He answered me and saved me from my enemy. Thus hope on Him, our radiant, there'll never be a shame. Never be ashamed.
This poor man cried, and the Lord heard me and saved me from my enemies. The Son of God surrounds His saints. He will deliver them.
Let us Originally, I'll just go ahead and do a little plug, and it's not because I'm biased, it's just because I'm a man that likes facts and deals with the facts. Faith Baptist Church has got the best children's department anywhere around here. Thank you, Paul and Mandy Hutchins, and all of your workers for all that you do. It is a goal, as you can see, that these children have a good time while they're back there, but that they learn about the Lord Jesus Christ. This isn't the church of tomorrow, this is the church of today. They're the ones that's going to elementary school, they're the ones that have friends, they're the ones that'll make a difference in the lives of the people around them, just like people made a difference in your life growing up, and you made a difference in others. They're the ones that'll be the Christian influence on those around them, amen? And it don't stop there. When you get to 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, Faith Baptist Church has the only middle school program in town that's dedicated just to middle school in our Emerge program. Come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. And Jason and Amber Ritter. So thank you. Thank you very much for all your hard work. Y'all give them one more. You want to be turning this morning your Bibles to the book of John, chapter number 10. John, chapter 10. This morning, we're going to continue looking under the subject matter. We've been under the title for the last 4 weeks of the Savior. I can't never even get past the title. The Savior is bigger than your situation. We've been looking at that now. This will be the fifth week under it, but can I tell you this morning that it doesn't matter what life hands you. It doesn't matter what's going on in your life. It doesn't matter what kind of circumstances are surrounding you in your life. It doesn't matter what kind of situations you're facing in your life. The Savior is bigger than your situation. In week number one, we looked at how Jesus is able to feed your body. We didn't really spend much time there, but when you're hungry, Jesus is able to feed your body even when there are some excruciating circumstances. We saw that he fed 5,000 men plus women and children with only 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes. And I told you that's about the equivalent of 5 biscuits and 2 little bream. and he fed 5,000 people. But the biggest part of that story was as they left Bethsaida and crossed over the Sea of Galilee, we went over to Capernaum with them, where Jesus taught us, it's not just if your body's hungry, I can take care of your body, but it's your soul that I'm here to take care of. And he taught us that I am the bread of life. In week number two, we went Matthew chapter 14. We backed up from Capernaum. We went back out to that little trip across the Sea of Galilee, because if you remember that night, Jesus went alone to pray, sent the disciples. They wound up in a storm. And we backed back up and we looked at the fact that if you just keep your eyes on Jesus, you can walk on water. We looked at a message that morning, learning how to walk on water. And what we saw that night was not just all of the disciples, but Peter being one of them. Peter was in a storm. Peter was in a bad situation. Peter was in a place where the water was over his head. He was in a place where the waves was over his head. The Bible says that the winds were boisterous. But Peter, with his eyes on Jesus, walked on his storms. You and I in this life have the ability to do the same things if we keep our eyes on Jesus. In the third week of the Savior is Greater Than the Situation, we looked at a story about a woman caught in the very act of adultery. And we saw how men brought her out and they threw her down in front of Jesus and they accused her and they brought her out. And what we saw that morning was that even when you are guilty, even when there is no denying what you've done, even when everyone else is looking down on you with their stones in their hands, grace is greater than sin. Last week we were here in John chapter 10. We looked at point number four, basically on this, we looked head on Jesus being the open door. Jesus is the open door to every problem, every situation, everything that goes on in our life. Jesus is the open door. We saw there in chapter 10, verse number 9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. That is the third of the seven I am statements in the book of John. This morning I want to look at the fourth of the seven statements where Jesus says I am. If you would, John chapter 10, we're going to begin reading in verse number 11. He says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. He that is an hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming, leaveth the sheep and fleeth, and the wolf catcheth them and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth because he is an hireling and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and am known of mine. Look down with me, if you would, at verse number 27. My sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give unto them eternal life. They shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave me them is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Father God, I thank you for your sweet Holy Spirit in this place. God, I thank you for your presence that I feel. God, I thank you, Lord, for your moving, Father. And I pray right now, will you continue in this place? God, I'm asking you, God, would you fill me with your Holy Spirit to the top? God, I pray you drive out any impurities, any imperfections, anything that's in me, God, that would hinder your Holy Spirit this morning. God, anything that would hinder you from speaking to me and anything that would hinder you from speaking through me, God, I pray you'd remove it right now. God, I pray you'd move in this place among your people this morning. God, I pray if there be any lost this morning and on their way to hell, God, I pray that today the blood of Jesus would reach down. I pray that the Holy Spirit would draw them. But God, I pray you not just stop with the lost this morning. God, I pray you'd move among your children. God, I pray this day that chains be broken. God, I pray that burdens be removed and those that are bound, that those things are taken off. God, I pray that broken homes and troubled marriages be reunited and restored. God, I pray you'd move in a mighty way and meet each one according to their own specific need on this day, God. Do what only you can do and take this one message, God, and make it personal to everybody in this place. Lord, we love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. In the New Testament, obviously, it starts off with the four Gospels, as we call them. That is four men's visual accounts of the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. Every one of those four accounts are perfectly correct. Every one of those four accounts are very informative, full of wisdom and knowledge and great information. But the writings of John is a little bit different from that of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. The book of Matthew starts out with the genealogy. We get all of the life of Christ as it comes down through it, all of chapter 1, and tells us about the family tree. And over in chapter 2, it deals with the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. We look at Luke, and we get the great story of the birth of Jesus Christ and shepherds abiding in the field, watching their flock by night, and we get all those stories. But John's very different. John doesn't really give us anything about the genealogies. He doesn't really give us anything back to the past to talk about the life. He just says very simply, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Of all of the descriptive images that John gives us of the Lord Jesus Christ, and as a matter of fact, the four Gospels as a whole, of all of the descriptive images that we get, I don't know that any of them could mean much more to us than this one, that Jesus is the Good Shepherd. Because the Good Shepherd cares for the sheep. And because He cares for the sheep, He takes care of the sheep. If Jesus is my shepherd, anybody listening? If Jesus is my shepherd and I am His sheep, that means I have one duty in this life, and that is to follow the shepherd. If He is indeed my shepherd, I don't have to worry about anything else. I am to put my trust in Him. I am to put all of my hope, all of my trials, all of my troubles, all of my situations, everything that affects this life, I am to put everything in His hands. He is the one that leadeth me beside the still waters. He is the one that prepareth a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. He is the one that restoreth my soul. He is the one that leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. In Psalm chapter 22, we see that He is the Good Shepherd. Psalm chapter 23, we see that He is the Great Shepherd. Psalm chapter 24, we see that He is the Chief Shepherd. The Psalms are some incredible writings. Those are incredible books of the Bible. They share incredible knowledge, and they have great wisdom, and there's a lot to be learned from the reading of the Psalms. Amazing passages, no doubt, but the reading of the Psalms is not the solution to your situation. I want to read a story to you real quick. You're welcome to pull it up. I read this off the internet, and I just copied and pasted and printed it out, so you can look at it if you want. But the story is told of an actor who is known for his readings and recitations from the classics. So this was a very educated man. This was a man that was a very eloquent speaker, and he took stories and tales, and he told things, and he put life into them, and he was so well trained. But the story says that he always ended his performance with a dramatic recital of Psalm 23. Each night, without exception, as the actor began his recitation, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." The crowd would listen attentively and then rise with a thunderous applause and appreciation of the actor's ability to bring the Psalms to life. One night, just before the actor was to offer his customary recital of Psalm 23, a young man from the audience stood up and said, "Sir, would you mind if tonight I recite Psalm 23? The actor, surprised by this unusual request, but however, he invited the young man to come onto the stage to recite the psalm, curious to see how the ability of this youth weighed against his own talents. Softly, the young man began to recite the words of the psalm, and when he was finished, there was no applause. There was no standing ovation as all other nights. All that could be heard was the sound of weeping. The audience had been so moved by the youth's recitation that every eye was tearful. Amazed by what he'd experienced, the actor queried, "I don't understand. I've been performing Psalm 23 for years. I have a lifetime of experience and training, but I've never been able to move an audience as you've moved them tonight. Tell me, young man, what is your secret?" The young man humbly replied, "Sir, you know the Psalms, but I know the Shepherd." There's a big difference in knowing the Psalms and knowing the Shepherd. I tell you what, I'm going to take just a minute. Miss Frieda, can you put the 23rd Psalms up there for me? If you could pull that up real quick. We got all this computer technology. We can or we can't? Huh? We can? We have it. Y'all stand up with me. Stand up with me. Can we read that together? "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Before you sit down, I have a question. Is that a recital to you, or is that a personal testimony? Thank you. You can be seated. For those who know the Psalms, that doesn't mean very much this morning. But for those of us who have been in the valley of the shadow of death, for those of us who know we've been in the grips of Satan, for those of us whose God has shown up when you were surrounded by wolves and prepared a table before you in the presence of your enemies, for those of you who God has shown up in the midst of your storm, and thy rod and thy staff, they did comfort me in the times of the storm. It's because we don't just know the psalm. We know the shepherd. Amen. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. We live in a society today. Met a lot of people yesterday. I heard a lot of new stuff. I was amazed at how many people I heard. So they were looking for a church home. You don't usually hear that a lot. You usually hear, I have one. I just can't remember the name of it. That's the truth. Well, just what's your pastor's name? That's good. Okay. But we live in a society where a lot of people, they like to call themselves Christians. They'll tell you they're going to heaven. Well, I hope I am. And, well, I'd like to, but most of them can't give you the real reason. I try to do right. I go to church. I try to live right. I'm not casting stones over there. I'm just telling you, as you talk to people, that's what you get. Very seldom do you get that I'm going to heaven because Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. The blood of Jesus has washed away all my sins, set my feet upon a rock, and saved my soul. I'm going to heaven because I deserve hell, but Jesus said you don't have to. I've accepted the gift. Jesus paid the price for my sin. I ought to be in hell today. If he threw me in hell today, he'd be right in doing so, but he's not going to because of what Jesus Christ did for me. We live in a society where people say, well, you know, I don't have to go to church. Well, you're right, you don't. That's obvious. Well, you know, I can sit home and read my Bible. Yes, you can, but if you're reading the real Bible and you're reading it very much, you're going to find yourself in church. Well, you know, there ain't nothing in the Bible. Don't sound like going to church. Well, I beg to differ with that one. People sit home. Listen, let me tell you something. Jesus started the church. Jesus built the church. And Jesus loves the church. And if you are following the shepherd, you're going to wind up in the church. Because the shepherd comes to the church. One of the texts that I use when I perform a wedding, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 23. My friend Alex and I talked about it briefly out there yesterday. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church. He is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ. You telling me Jesus don't love the church? As the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. But in verse number 25, he says, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. You can't love something so much that you're willing to die for it and not want to spend any time with it. Amen. Not ever want to be around it. You, if you can stay out of church and you can't love the things of God, you can't just stay away from church. You can't stay away from God's children, God's people, God's singing, God's word. You can't stay away from giving tithes unto the Lord according to the commandments of God. You can't stay away from those things and say you love the church. Amen. So if you don't love the church, do you know the Savior? Do you know the shepherd? Or do you just know the Psalms? If you remember last week, continuing on this week, we looked at Jesus as the door. He's the door of the sheepfold, but he's also the shepherd of the sheep. Last week in point number one, I told you that the door is a person. This isn't some wooden, removable, replaceable, exchangeable object. Jesus said, I am the door. So the door is a person. You remember last week, it's also a proposal. I am the door by me. If any man enter in, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. Now, we have both a proposal and a promise there in that text, and that's where we were last week. Never before Jesus Christ has the door and the shepherd been the same person. You had the porter, but then again, never before has the Word become flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus says, I am now not only the door of the sheepfold, but I'm the shepherd of the sheep. A couple weeks ago, it may not even been that long ago, I don't know, I was sitting there looking at some stuff on my phone, looking through the internet, and I was looking at some things at the Golden Gate Bridge, and Robin's like, why are you looking at that stuff? Well, the truth is, I'm always looking at something. She'll tell you, if I'm sitting in the TV's on, I'm always looking, and sometimes it's just Bible verses, times stuff, and I'm just, my mind's always searching. And I was looking at something at the Golden Gate Bridge, and what I was looking at was suicides. I was looking at dealing. Dealing with people who don't think they have a way out. They think they've done so much that God can never forgive them. They think there's no hope for them. Can I tell you this morning, that ain't true. Jesus is your hope. And if he can forgive me, he can forgive anything you've ever done. There are no limits to his grace. There are no limits to his mercy. But I was studying and I found that 46 people jumped from the Golden Gate Bridge last year. That's almost one person a week. That's how they chose to kill themselves. So I studied a little more and I found out August of 1937, just 3 months after the bridge was opened, the first person, a man by the name of H.B. Woober, became the first one to commit suicide by jumping off of the Golden Gate Bridge. Since that day, over 1,600 people have committed suicide that way. On an average, since the time that's been open, somebody jumps from that bridge every 2 weeks. There are 11 telephones on that bridge that are crisis counselor telephones. All you have to do is pick it up, and there's automatically a counselor on the other end trained in suicide prevention. Yet on an average of every 2 weeks, people choose to jump. So it led me to another study. If on an average everybody jumps every 2 weeks, I got to looking at the death toll, at the total death toll, and the total death toll led me back to the building of the bridge. The building of the bridge was $35 million. In that day, they figured when they were building a huge construction project like that, the expected death toll was one person per every $1 million spent. That means that on a $35 million project, 35 people would fall to their death during that project. Yet only 11 people died constructing the bridge. But then it went on to tell the reason why. Just 6 months before the San Francisco-Oakland Bay Bridge was opened, 28 people lost their lives while building that bridge. The reason the majority of them died was because they failed building the bridge. So when they built the Golden Gate Bridge, they constructed a net so that if people failed, the net would catch them. So the reason that only 11 men died during this $35 million project was because of the net. Everybody with me? This is good. I don't want you to miss this. Look around. Wake them up. Tell them wake up for just a minute. I'll give them this. They can catch them another nap. We'll wake them back up in a minute. The net didn't keep the men from falling. The net just kept them from utter destruction. Some of you didn't get that. The net didn't keep the men from falling. It just saved them when they fell. It just caught them on the way down. they would send a boat out and get them out of the net and put them back to work. That's what the good shepherd did for every believer in this room. That's what he does for us every day of our life. Because whenever you fall, I didn't say if you fall. Whenever you fall, children of God, he is the net that will catch you, save you from utter destruction, get you out of the net, and put you back to work. They say that when you jump from that bridge, that the impact on the water is 75 miles per hour. Of the more than 1,600 that jumped, they say all but 30 of them died at the point of impact. Because they fell the entire distance at the point of impact, they were utterly destroyed. Jesus is the net that catches me when I fall, and he picks me up. Matthew chapter 19, Jesus said, "For the Son of Man has come to save that which was lost. How think ye if a man have 100 sheep and one of them be gone astray, doth he not leave the 99 and goeth into the mountains and seeketh that which is gone astray? If so be that he find it, verily I say unto you, he rejoiceth more of that sheep than of the 99 which went not astray. Even so, it is not the will of your Father which is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish." Jesus said, when you fall, I'll leave the 99. I'll come looking for you to save you and to bring you back. Maybe I'm in this by myself. Anybody in here ever strayed before? Anybody ever found yourself lost before and he had to come get you and bring you back? Anybody in here ever stumbled? Anybody ever fell in here before? Anybody besides me? I don't know. I know I've fallen. There's times I should have been destroyed. But Jesus was my net. Caught me before I was utterly destroyed. I will tell you this. You keep running red lights and you keep saying, I'm going to do this my way. Impact's coming. Impact's coming. But the Savior's hand, thank God for grace, continues to catch us and pick us up. Before I move on, some of you may be falling in here this morning. It's okay. Grace is greater than sin. You just can't keep going that way. Some of you in here may be struggling with something this morning. You need to quit, and you know it, and the Holy Spirit is dealing with you. Maybe you're doing some stuff you ain't supposed to be doing, and you know it. It's okay, but you got to turn around now. There's a net that'll catch you and save you from utter destruction, but you need to get turned around now. Anybody in here ever made any decisions that you wish you wouldn't have made? Anybody ever done anything in your past that you wish you could undo? Anybody in here ever done anything that you'd be ashamed to talk about in this environment? Mm-hmm. Thank God for the net that'll catch us when we fall. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. Thank God for you and I today that we live in this dispensation period of grace. In the Old Testament, we have a dispensation of the law. They lived under the law. In the Old Testament, there were types. In the Old Testament, there were foreshadows. Types are good. Types look like the image. Types bear a strong resemblance of the natural image, but a type is not the shepherd. A foreshadow. A shadow is an image. There's a shadow there that is an image of what it is, but a shadow is not the real thing. In the Old Testament, there's some types. There are some foreshadows, but they're not the real thing. Y'all remember Abel? Abel was a righteous shepherd. Abel offered a sacrifice. The Bible says a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. Cain was ticked off about the situation. And Cain killed his brother. Abel was a righteous shepherd, but he was just a type. He wasn't the true shepherd. Jacob was a type. Y'all remember Jacob? Holding on to his twin brother's heel at birth, came out, Jacob and Esau. Y'all know the story. Jacob was a type. If you remember, the father only had one blessing that went to the eldest son. You remember how Jacob, with the help of his mom, deceived his father. He not only stole the birthright, he stole the blessing. And because of that, his brother was going to kill him. So he had to run. And he ran and he fled. But the Bible says that one night, he wrestled with a man, and that man was an angel. I don't have time to read the whole story to you. It's in Genesis chapter 32 if you want to read the story. But the angel said, "You've got to let me go." He said, "I'm not letting you go till you bless me." Angel said, "What's your name?" He said, "Jacob." He said, "Thou shalt no longer be called Jacob. You shall be called Israel. For as a prince, thou hast power with God and with men and hast prevailed." Esau was coming to kill Jacob, but God went before him. So when the two met, Esau's coming to kill his brother's coming in fear. When the two met, because God went ahead of his child, because God intervened, when the two met, there wasn't this great fight, and there wasn't one killing the other. The Bible says that they fell on each other's neck, and they kissed each other, all because God went before him. See, that's what Jesus did for you and I on the cross. He went on to the Father. He went ahead of us. He went before you and I. And he took God's righteous hand, and my filthy hand, and joined them hand in hand. He was a type, but he wasn't the shepherd. Moses was a type. Y'all remember Moses? Y'all remember in the day God's children, they were in the bondage of Egypt, and they were crying out to God to come and save them. But while they were moaning, God was moving. God was doing something. Y'all remember that the Pharaoh said, "Take all the Hebrew boys that are born and drown them in the Nile River." But the Bible tells us that there was a little boy named Moses, said that Ochabed and Amram had this little boy named Moses, and they saw that he was holy, he was different, and they decided they're going to have to save this little boy, and they made a little basket out of some bulrush, and they hid him in the river, and every day they sent Miriam, his sister, down to keep an eye on him. But then one day, God sent Pharaoh's daughter down to the river. See, they floated him in the Nile River. Y'all didn't catch that yet. They floated him in the same river that they were supposed to drown him in. Passed about the front three rows, y'all still ain't got it. A situation that was supposed to do you in. A situation that was supposed to have destroyed you on impact. God reached in and pulled you out so that instead of destroying you, it made you stronger. Hallelujah. God reached down and he used the same Nile River that should have been his deathbed and turned it into his floating bed. God can do the same thing with your situation. Things that the enemy designed to destroy you, to take you out, God can turn that into your growing path. Some people... Matter of fact, I don't know, some of you may be in here today. Anybody in here felt like you'd never stop hurting? But then all of a sudden, joy cometh in the morning. One day you broke through and God put a smile back on your face. You thought you'd never stop crying, but God wiped the tears from your eyes. One day, God did what only God could do and nobody else could. You thought you'd never overcome your situation. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, God came in and made a way out of no way. One day, God had the Pharaoh's daughter go down to the Nile to take a bath. You say, "Well, God didn't have her go down to the Nile to take a bath. She just had to take a bath once a day." No, 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 no. You need to study. You need to study more. In the Pharaoh's palace, there was running water, hot and cold. She could have had the servants bring her a bath and took a hot bath if she wanted to. On that day, God sent her down to the river. She thought she was going down there to take a bath. But God was sending her down there to get a baby. God had something for her to do. So she got down to the river. And at just the right time, in just the right way, God shook that basket so that that baby boy cried. I want you to understand something this morning. That baby didn't cry in Hebrew. He didn't cry in Egyptian. He didn't cry in the Greek language. He just cried. Because God hears your tears. God hears tears. God can see the hurt. God understands the pain. So the baby cried. And then you know the story how God worked it out so that Moses' own mother nurtured up Moses. He's raised up in the Pharaoh's palace, but he's raised by his own mother. So after Moses grew up, there was an Egyptian beating one of the Hebrew slaves, and Moses got in a fight with him, and he killed that Egyptian. not too far after that, two Hebrews got in a fight. Moses says, break it up, break it up, break it up, cut that out. And they said, why? What are you going to do? You're going to kill us like you did the Egyptian? Fear struck in Moses because people knew about it. So he had to flee. So you have this man that was living in the Pharaoh's palace. Now he's a fugitive from Pharaoh. Several years later, over on the other side of the Midian desert, God shows up in a burning bush. The Bible says the bush burned, but it was not consumed. And Moses said, I'll now turn aside and see this great sight. So he went aside and he told Moses, take your shoes off. Take off your sandals, for the ground that you're standing on is holy ground. But here's what he said. I'm going to send you back to deliver my people. See, Moses was a type, but he's not the shepherd. One day Jesus, the shepherd, is coming back to get his people. He's coming back to get his sheep. He's coming back to deliver. So don't worry about what you're going through right now. Jesus is coming back. I'm almost done. Y'all don't write me off. Jesus already come one time. He said, I am the good shepherd. He was arrested. He was accused of crimes that he never committed. He was brought from Pilate to Herod and back to Pilate. And they carried him and they tried him and they made accusations, accused him of all kinds of stuff. And all night long, yet he openeth not his mouth. In spite of all the things they had to say, yet he openeth not his mouth. Until Pilate said, do you not know who I am? I have the power to crucify you on a Roman cross. I have the power to set you free. And Jesus said, you hold on right there. I've listened to a lot, but there's something you need to understand, old boy. You could have no power over me at all, except to be given to you from my Father, which is above. I am the good shepherd. I lay down my life for the sheep. Neither you nor nobody else can take it. I have the power to lay my life down. And if I have the power to lay it down, I have the power to take it up again. Mm-hmm. We started out this morning just pretty simple. Do you know the Psalms? Or do you know the shepherd? And a flock of sheep. I started to put you up a picture, but it's kind of pointless because it's just the same thing. They all look alike. To the untrained eye, they're just a bunch of fluffy white things. A little head on the front and some feet. And then when you trim them up, they're all just a bunch of little bitty skinny white things. But they got all their hair cut off. Kind of like all those little frou-frou dogs that we do. You know, they get up and they get all fluffy and we carry them, get them cut, and they come back and like, where'd this dog come from? Kind of the same. They all look alike to the untrained eye. But to the shepherd, he can tell them apart by their imperfections. He can tell them apart by their defects. See, we look around and here this morning, we can't tell by looking at one another who knows the Psalms and who knows the shepherd. Well, you can tell me what you want me to hear and I can believe what you say. But I don't have the ability to see who is a child and who is an imposter. Only the shepherd knows that. Jesus knows our defects, but he also knows what we're going through. He knows what you're going through. He knows what you're going through. He knows what your situation is. He knows what your situation is. He understands your problems. He understands your troubles. He knows about your trials. He understands your problems. He knows about your troubles. He knows about your trials. But he can also rescue you from all your troubles, save you from all your trials, lift you above every situation. And he can do the same for you over here. Let me give you a story right here, and I'm done. This is another one. It's off the internet, so you can read it if you want to prove it. But in Australia, sheep farming is still a big deal. There's a lot of money in sheep farming over there, and because of that, sheep rustling is on the rise. There was a trial in a court of law. One man accused another man of stealing his sheep. The defendant in the case said, that is my sheep. I didn't steal the sheep. He's mine. The accuser said, no, he's my sheep. He stole the sheep. And so the judge listened to the argument for about 30 minutes. Finally, he said, we're not getting anywhere with this. He said to the accuser, you, go stand over there by that wall. He sent him over there. And he said, you, the accused, you go stand over there by that wall. He told the bailiff, he said, go get me the sheep and bring him in here. Went out and he got the sheep and he brought it in and the sheep couldn't see the men. He looked over to the accuser and he said, call the sheep. He said, do what? He said, call the sheep. Man called the sheep, sheep wouldn't come. He got in, come here, you dumb sheep, come over here. The sheep never came. Judge said, that's enough. He looks over to the accused, and he says, call the sheep. And as soon as he opened his mouth, the sheep ran to the man. And he got all around him. See, our text this morning says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Jesus is the good shepherd. And just as he gave his life for the sheep, he's coming back to get his sheep. There's going to be an accuser that's going to accuse you of all your sins. And he's going to say to the judge, that's my sheep. Those are my sheep. Look at their sin. Look at what they did. Look at the lies. Look at the cheating. Look at the stealing. Look at the adultery. Look at the drugs. Look at what they did. Those are my sheep. But the real shepherd says, judge, paid in full. And his sheep hear his voice. Chapter 25 of Matthew, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then he shall sit upon the throne of his glory, and before him shall be gathered all nations. He shall separate them one from another as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats. I'm sorry, y'all picked which side of the room to sit on this morning. He set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on his left. Maybe I ought to turn around and do it again so everybody gets on the good side. Then shall the king say to them on his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom that is prepared for you for the foundation of the world. But then Jesus said to the other side, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. This morning, do you know the Psalms? Or do you know the shepherd? And if you know the shepherd, are you following his voice? I heard a lot of times yesterday as I talked to people, I'm saved, I just ain't living right. I'm saved, I just ain't doing right, I need to get back in church. If you truly are one of his sheep, hear his voice. We only have one job in this life, and that is to follow the shepherd, amen? Could I have you stand this morning? If I could have you stand, if I could have heads bowed, eyes closed, just for a minute. The altars are always open. You know that. Anybody that wants to come talk to your shepherd, you're welcome to come tell him thank you for what he's done. You're welcome to come just, you can bring your needs. You do whatever you need. You come do business with the Lord. But let me ask you a question this morning. If you know the shepherd, you know that the shepherd will come looking for you when you're lost. If you know the shepherd, you know that the shepherd will catch you when you fall. If you know the shepherd, then you know that the shepherd will bind up your wounds and give healing when you're hurt. If you know the shepherd, then you know that the shepherd is the one that will protect you from the wolves, protect you from the enemy, and keep you safe. If you know the shepherd, then you know the shepherd's voice. But more importantly, he knows yours. He hears you when you call. He hears you when you cry. He understands the language of a tear. You don't have to cry in Hebrew this morning. You don't have to cry in the Greek language this morning. All you have to do is cry out, Father, I need some help. If he is indeed your shepherd. Philip, you play that invitation song. I want to play a song here just for a minute. You listen to this song.
We're glad you could join us for today's services. If you've received Christ as your Savior, or if you'd like more information on how to receive Christ as your Savior, or just more information on the church, you can contact us at 706-884-3100. Our office hours are from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m., Monday through Friday. We're located at 552 Hammett Road in LaGrange, Georgia. Our Sunday morning services are at 9:30 a.m. for Sunday school, 10:30 for the worship service, and 6 p.m. for the Sunday evening service. Wednesday nights are at 7 o'clock with something for all ages. You can get more information on our website at faithlagrange.com. We really love to see you join us at Faith. Until next time, God bless you. We love you.